rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 23 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. You guys are in for a treat because today I am joined by none other than the EntrepreNewHER, Shan Thomas. Now, I've had a lot of great guests on the show that really bring it, like Brian Fanzo and Dory Clark, and I tells you that none of them have come harder than Shan because she lit her mic on fire. Shan Thomas is a creative marketing specialist that provides smart, tech-savvy small business women with the leverage of technology and marketing strategies that work. Her strengths lie in her ability to conceive and implement the strategic marketing plans, identify new market opportunities, initiate product and service introductions, and negotiate strategic collaborations to drive market expansion and revenue growth. I tell you guys, get buckled in and ready to blast off with my interview with the EntrepreNewHER, Shan Thomas. Shan, thanks so much for talking with me.
Thanks so much for having me on the show. I'm super excited.
So the road to being a professional digital marketer tends to be a winding one. And yours was especially crazy because you went from six figures. And I'm not talking about the two zeros after the decimal point, people. I'm talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars. She went from that to being a full-time EntrepreNewHER. So tell us that story. When did you first get bit by the bug and how did you become enchanted enough to take that leap?
Well, I can say that I don't think that I became enchanted. What happened was I became disenfranchised from what I was doing in corporate America. And it was so much so that I just had to, you know, take that leap out of that plane and without a parachute. It was just that serious. As a woman in business, it's a little bit different. Climbing that corporate ladder and everything that we have to, you know, traverse with going up the ladder and getting there, just to be hit with all of the stereotypes and the misconceptions and the prejudices. And it's not even just about, you know, what I look like. It really is an attack on women in corporate America. And that's what I faced. So it came to a point where I did what I was supposed to do. I got the degrees to get the credentials to be an executive. And then when I got there, there was just a lot of attacks, and it came to the point where I had to make a decision. I'm a mom. I had four beautiful children at home who were counting on me to make sure that everything stayed afloat. And we lived a very, you know, a very nice middle-class lifestyle that that job afforded me. But at the end of the day, what was more important was that I maintained my morals, my ethics, and my integrity. So when that became an issue, when corporate America became an issue with me having to check who I was as a person, I just had to take the leap and step off that boat because it wasn't worth it, you know? So when I became an entrepreneur, it wasn't because that was something that was in my, that I saw in my future. I honestly have always been, I bought into the idea of the American dream. You do what you're supposed to do. You get the degrees, you go to work, you work hard, and you climb the ladder. And that's what I thought was going to be my journey. You retire, get your watch, you know, your gold chain or whatever they give you. And that's what you do. But that just, it just didn't sit well. So when I became an entrepreneur, I literally walked away and just said, I'm going to start a consultancy doing what I did in corporate America. And I can go into the story of how I got into digital marketing, because that is not how I started. I started as, I was in transportation, so supply chain management, things of that nature. So I became a broker. I was a broker for transportation small transportation companies. And I started with, I was just going to broker their work. I was going to be that middle person to secure those contracts, because that's what I did in corporate, negotiate contracts, million-dollar deals, making sure that things were working out for the small owner operators of the transportation industry. But what I found was those guys, these small companies, even though they were making a lot of money, didn't have processes and procedures in place, and they built their whole business around handshakes. No marketing, no website, no material, no real systems. So as someone coming from corporate, knowing how corporate think, I'm coming from the outside trying to market them as someone that another company wants to attract and be attractive to do business with them. I had nothing. Like, there was nothing. So I had to do that research and find out how can I help these people market their business. And that's when I dived into the marketing side of everything. And in being in Atlanta, there's all kind of events that go on. And I really found this amazing event that was talking about digital marketing. I had no clue. If I tell you the truth, I was the executive who relied on administrative assistants to do anything on the internet for me. I didn't do internet. I did Excel.
Right.
So for me to be trying to, you know, travel through the internet, it was scary because I wasn't familiar, but I was interested in the technology. I was interested in the thought process of Google search and what it meant to figure out how to navigate the Google search engine so that you can manipulate what happened. And I just bit the apple and never turned back.
That's a tremendous story. I can see that being turned into a made-for-TV movie. Because when I say they call them golden handcuffs for a reason, I hear what you were saying. But if I'm getting six figures, whew, they'd have to drag me up out of there. So salute you. Can't do nothing but respect that. So if you had a time machine and you can go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watched Doctor Who. What are the three things that you would tell yourself to help prepare for where you are now in your career?
I would tell myself that it gets better and don't sweat the small thing and trust your instinct. So number two would be trust your instinct. And number three would be to dive all in to technology from birth, if possible. But literally, I would dive all into technology because at the end of the day, that is where everything was going, even when we were really, really young. I'm in my 40s. Even when I was really young, everything was happening with technology. And that was the field. That was the field that I was not pushed into because, first of all, I'm a girl. Second of all, growing up in the inner city, it wasn't readily available. It wasn't offered. But that's what I would tell myself. I would dive into those programs that seemed to be, quote unquote, outside of the realm or the scope of where I was possibly headed or could acquire knowledge.
Absolutely. Can't knock that. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future. So a lot of times in the digital marketing space, we talk about the Internet of Things and connected living, mobile, all that. And there's this phrase, closing the loop. And the example that everybody gives is your smart refrigerator, right? Your refrigerator knows when you're getting low on milk. And so it automatically adds milk to your shopping list. And then the Amazon drone brings you your groceries, right? Mm-hmm. So, what do you think the actual marketing landscape will look like when that becomes a reality? Because the milk has to get into the refrigerator in the first place, right? So, like, are grocery stores going to hire, like, salespeople to just go out and grab people? Because at that point, you don't have to go back into the store. So once, you know, the Internet of Things really kick off, how do you see that affecting marketing and people's daily lives?
Okay, so long time ago, when artificial intelligence, augmented reality first came out, I am that geek that took those classes and paid to travel to California and sit down and talk to people who were light years ahead of their time. And right. I still remember those conversations. And I believe that that's where we're headed and that's where we're going to be. Those things that I witnessed 6-7 years ago are not even at the cusp of the market right now, not in our space. Where I see what I learned 6 years ago happening is in the gaming industry. And what I believe, and if you watch the Super Bowl, you would have saw what I saw if you were looking at through different eyes, is that that's where everything is headed. Things are headed to be more along the lines of intelligent communication, and businesses and entrepreneurs and digital marketing in itself is going to have to learn how to interrupt habits and interrupt what's naturally going on so that they can be at the forefront. Things are going to move faster than ever. It's already going really, really fast. So you have to figure out how to interrupt the attention of already. If people are actually waiting on drones and Uber Eats, how can a marketer figure out how to intercept that communication and get the message in front of the eyes so they can have the attention.
There you go. So we are going to take a short break. This has been riveting. One of the better interviews, I must say. We're going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Shan Thomas. So stay with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multi-millionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Shan, you, Gary V, Tim Ferriss, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a digital marketing conference where they ain't speaking, you're all sitting at the bar at the conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
I think for me, there's missing personalization. Personality and personalization is missing from the digital marketing space. There's a lot of tech talk. There's a lot of gadgetry. There's a lot of algorithm phenomenon and long words that people really can't spell, but they're buzzwords. And they're taking the people out of the actual marketing. And I know tools, tricks, tips, technology is at the forefront. But if I'm to be serious, that I think that the personalization and those conversations are taking out, and it's more, you know, numbers and ones and zeros. But really, what I want to see in the digital marketing space is more from a different perspective. More from women in business, more from the perspective of, you know, how do women feel? What role do women play in the marketing sphere? What role do we play in the consumer sphere? Because we're the ones that make the buying decisions most times. We're the ones that are actually, we're the ones that are setting the trends as to what we want and how we want it delivered, how we want it to be worded and everything. And I see too many women talking like the Gary V and the, you know, the people that are John Lawson and all of these people who are thought leaders, you know, and I'm got my little air quotes up, but I don't hear enough from my perspective. I have been able, you know, how accessible Gary V is. I've had conversations online with him because the model doesn't work. It doesn't work for all of us. As an entrepreneur, I hear the stories of women. I hear the comparison beyond, oh, I should be doing this. I'm not hustling hard enough. You know, Gary V said he works 18 hours a day. But Gary V couldn't be Gary V if he didn't have Sasha in the background taking care of his kid.
Exactly.
So, you know, the Grant Cardones of the world couldn't do that if they didn't have their wives taking care of those kids. Eric Thomas says the same thing, and it's a different conversation that needs to be had. And I think that women need to be at the table as well, because we have women looking at these people as influencers, as thought leaders, as setting the trends, and it's not doable. It's not transferable. I cannot work 18 hours a day, take care of my daughter, make sure that the food is cooked, make sure I go to the grocery store, make sure nothing gets turned off, because husband is not focused on that because he's grinding. It's a different conversation. And even down to how digital marketing works, the wording matters. Copywriting matters, and not copywriting to the point of, you know, making sure that conversions happen. Yes, that's important. But making sure that you build customer loyalty, making sure that the Sears model of from the cradle to the grave, a customer stays with you, is going to be more relevant in the future than right now.
Shan, are you over here giving me whiplash? Because I'm just nodding my head, and I couldn't agree more. So without getting political, to the best of your ability, but by all means, you know, speak your mind. What's your whole take on the whole fake news backlash after the election? Because when the results first came out, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off. He was like, oh, it's highly unlikely Facebook had anything to do with it. Then he sort of backtracked and said, we take fake news very seriously. And just a few days ago, the Apple CEO Tim Cook, he came out and said that platforms need to have a campaign against fake news. And I'll be honest, Gemini that I am, I'm half in, half out. Part of me is like, yes, they should crack down on it. The other part of me is like, I really don't want this third party getting into what I have the right to say. So what's your opinion on how platforms handle fake news?
I honestly agree with the first iteration that Mark Zuckerberg gave, and that is it's really not relevant. They didn't have anything to do with anything. At the end of the day, social media is as social media is. It is a platform where anyone can say anything, and outside of harming and making terroristic threats, you pretty much have, you know, full range of doing whatever you want to do. I believe that there is, beyond fake news, there is an attack on intelligence. There is an attack on common decency to not just believe what is written and actually do research. Research is a word that I probably use every day, all day, every hour of the day. And if I had a dollar for every time, I wouldn't be talking to you right now being Aruba.
That's right.
At the end of the day, there is a blatant attack against smart, intelligent thought, just thinking. And we got to do more than just linearly think. We have to really look at the whole picture. And if you are reading something and you don't diligently do your due research, that is your problem if you believe that. Because that could be detrimental to you in more than just politics or whatever is going on in the world. That could be detrimental to your health, to your child welfare, to your family household, to your investments. So I think that more than trying to figure out who's telling what and who's lying to who, you need to be figuring out how smart are you and how easy is it for you to be duped into believing something that is untrue because you didn't take the time. You just clicking and sharing. You didn't take the time to do your due diligence and do your research.
Woo! Fire, fire, fire. This is, I love it. Scintillating. So, you come from a background of having worked with a large corporation, and just generally speaking, large corporations have been kind of slow to adopt digital. They were kind of waiting and seeing how it was doing, and they are just now starting to put some real muscle behind it. However, if you look at the numbers, that ad spend is disproportionately going to Facebook and Google. So there's been this theory posited that we are entering a time where we're going to have the haves and the have-nots in terms of digital marketing, because, you know, law of supply and demand, as more corporate dollars flow into Facebook ads and Google ads, that's going to push up the price, and that's going to push out a lot of the smaller players, which kind of goes against the whole free nature of the internet as well. So do you think that we will get to a point in time where the internet as a whole is going to be pay to play? And if so, like, how do small businesses react in that space?
I don't think so. I think that that goes against the whole monetary model of how ads work. If people are not, tell people this all the time, that the majority of folks are not on social media to buy anything. They're on social media to be entertained, to be educated, to just, you know, break up some monotonous time and, you know, really just live a life that they don't really live in real life. So let's be honest. So when you come to the point where every other post is from Coca-Cola or Dunkin' Donuts, that then dissuades you from being on that platform. There's a reason why network television is not watched live, that it is 9 times out of 10 watched on DVR, so that people can get around the marketing messages. Now, small companies have the advantage in that they are not big companies. And if they're smart, they would work with digital marketers who understand that and understand attention as well as customer habits and what's going on. Now, as far as big brands coming in, taking over, all of that is great news for the social media platforms that have ads been to buy. But they also hopefully are smart enough to understand what I just said, is that people that are willing to buy are going to jump off, and all you'll have is a platform full of ads, which is not sustainable because there are no buyers. So I don't think that that would possibly ever be the case, only because that is not, that there's no scale and balance in that. It makes no sense.
Very interesting perspective. I love it. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I really do appreciate you taking the time. This has been just one of the better experiences I've had doing the show. But I am going to take just a few minutes to set the question up, because I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it.
Okay.
So it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his podcast, if you're familiar with it. But I'm spinning it because, in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a corporation or an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they are professional because they operate at such a high level. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. So just in terms of, like I said, career trajectory, there's sort of three ways that people find themselves in the industry. They start out meandering the wilds of Google. And there's some very good information out there, but there's no guarantees on Google. You might end up on lynda.com. You might end up in Amway, right? Like, who knows? And then after you do that for a year or 10, you get serious and you can do what I did, which is go back to school for a degree specific to digital marketing. The problem with that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000, and it's time consuming, because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete, and a lot can happen in 30 months, especially in the digital marketing space. So by far the more prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars. That's actually where I met you, was at a conference. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot cheaper than going to get a bachelor's degree, you have to have the money up front. So a lot of these better conferences, like your South by Southwest or your MozCon, something like that, you're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That don't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food. That don't include none of that. Just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all that stuff back in, you easily looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And so what ends up happening is that you don't see a lot of people of color at these things because we're priced out. So I'm trying to crowdsource a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to come out of pocket a few grand, which you might not have, to go through a conference. So now that I just spent all that time setting up the last question, I'll ask it, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world. identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Sean. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
You asking me a question that I did in real life.
Go for it.
What I would do is I would make me a list of the top 10 people who I needed to be in their network. I wanted to be their right-hand people, and I would add value. Because I'm intelligent, because I'm smart, actually just brilliant by far, I know exactly, I'll do my research, and I'll know exactly what they need. I'll know exactly where they were, what's coming up on their itinerary, because people tell you everything. The boardrooms are open. I'll meet them at, you know, if they're going to be taking pictures at the local Starbucks, I'll meet them there, happen to meet them there, share with them how I can assist them, and then offer my services with my laptop to tweet for them. What I've done is actually interjected myself to get their attention by offering to assist and help further their agenda. So if I am working for free on my laptop and they're going to be at conference, I'm going to be doing live time social media for them. I'm going to be answering emails and following up and making sure that connections are made. I'm going to be retweeting and double tweeting and hashtagging all along the lines of turning that webcam on, and I'm going to be on Periscope talking about where they're going to be. I'm going to just be their biggest advocate, biggest person who's connecting dots, that as they are doing their, as they are in the world doing their brilliance, I'm behind the scenes making it bigger. That's what I would do. And reciprocity? Oh.
Absolutely. Sean, this has been tremendous. Please take a moment, tell people where we can get a hold of you. If you have any books or products coming out, where can we get some more of you?
Awesome. Well, I am the EntrepreneurHER. So all things women in business is what I stand for. My whole mission in life is to make sure that women who want to own their own business can create one that they love, they connect with other like-minded ladies, and that we collaborate effectively. So I am on all social media at Shan Thomas Biz, and that is spelled Shan is S-H-A-N-T-H-O-M-A-S-B-I-Z on everything. My favorite social media platform is Facebook, of course. And secondarily, it's going to be Instagram. But as far as what I have going on, I have no books per se. I will have my book launch at my big event in March. In Atlanta, Georgia, I host a major event for all my EntrepreneurHERs, as well as the supportive men in our circle. It's March 25th. It is at the beautiful Fernbank Museum. And it's from 10 o'clock in the morning to 3 p.m. in the afternoon. And it is an amazing day of amazing speakers who are successful in their own right, coming in to tell their story of trial, of triumph, and help us get over the hurdles that we have so that we can be successful too. So it's a day of inspiration, a day of motivation, but I am all about the bottom line, so we do business as well.
There you have it, folks. March 25th, if you're in Atlanta, Georgia, you want to have your face in that place, check out Shan. As you can see, she brings the heat, holds no punches, and is full of value. So, Shan, thank you so much for your time.
Oh, thank you. I enjoyed this. I appreciate you.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.